Okay, so resistance welding is basically a part of solid liquid, basically welding process, where the weld is basically in the form of solid and liquid both. As you saw in the video of solid state welding process, let's say in the friction stir welding or in friction welding, what you could see is that the friction creates a solid plastic. Okay, a melt is not created, only a solid plastic is created. The material is heated, it becomes red hot, but it still does not melt. And while it is red hot, we apply pressure. So while it is red hot, under pressure it joins. The metallurgy is basically the new grain boundaries are formed, and those grain boundaries basically join and converge together. So first, with the help of friction, I create heat. With high heat now, without melting, then I apply some pressure, and once I apply some pressure, a bond is created. That is why it is called solid state welding. Usually melting does not occur, but there is one type of solid state welding which is a mix or intermediate between fusion welding and solid state welding. That is called resistance welding. Resistance welding is between fusion welding and solid state welding. Why is that? Because in fusion welding, we melt a material. Whereas in solid state welding, we don't melt a material. In resistance welding, sometimes we melt the material but apply pressure, and sometimes we don't melt a material and apply pressure. So resistance welding basically falls under the category of both fusion welding and solid state welding. In the book, in our book of Kalpak John, the one which I've shared with you guys, resistance welding is falling under the category of solid state welding. However, there are some cases where it falls under the category of fusion welding when only melting also occurs. Okay, so before we move on, this was basically just a preamble or the introduction to resistance welding. Okay, so before we start and we go through resistance welding, we know that manufacturing process are basically divided into two main categories. Number one is processing operations, and number two is assembly and operations. Okay. In processing operations, we know we have got shaping process, we have got turning, milling, grinding, casting. This is all that you have learned already in your manufacturing process subject. But what we have not gone through in detail is the assembly operations. And in assembly operations also, we have got two processes. One is permanent joining process and one is mechanical fastening. Our subject only covers permanent joining process, which is welding, brazing, soldering, and adhesive bonding. So our subject path is basically starting from assembly. Okay, then we go to permanent joint, and then we cover these three topics. Okay, so we should know that in manufacturing, where are we standing? So now that we know where we are standing, so let's take a look at the classification of welding once again. Okay, so when we talk about joining and welding process, okay, we have got three main paths, which is welding and adhesive bonding. Okay, in welding we have got fusion, which Prof is currently covering, then we have got brazing and soldering, and then we have got solid state welding. Okay, in fusion, as you can see, we have got chemical, okay, and electrical type. In chemical, we have got oxy fuel gas welding, we have got thermite welding. In electrical, we know that an electric arc is produced, so that those are arc welding processes. And here you can see we have got resistance welding as well. So we have got resistance welding here as well. Okay, so resistance welding is in the fusion welding. If you go to solid state welding, if you can see here, you got electrical, and then if you got resistance welding once again here. That is why I said earlier on, the electrical resistance welding is basically both in fusion welding as well as in solid state welding, because sometimes it produces melting and sometimes it does not produce melting. So it is basically a combination or intermediate between resistance and fusion and solid state welding. So do remember this point, that resistance welding can be a part of both types of welding techniques, either fusion or solid state welding. Once we go through the process, then we will know why we say that resistance welding is in both fusion and solid state welding, both. Why it falls in the both of these categories. So we are covering joining process, then metallurgical process welding, then fusion welding. Okay, Prof is covering arc welding process. Okay, and these processes, high energy density process. Then we have got pressure welding or solid state welding, where we have got forge welding and resistance welding. And in resistance welding, we are going to cover all of these types of resistance welding. So in this classification, you can see that it is also under pressure welding process. So what are going to be the contents of our today's lecture? Today's lecture will be on the introduction to the process. Okay, we will go through the process first, then fundamentals, what is the mechanism by which a joint is formed in resistance welding. Then the quality control issues, how to control the quality for resistance welding process. Then what are the types of different resistance welding process that I will join and merge with some videos. Then we will go through a derivation or like say formulas for resistance welding, and then we will cover some numericals for resistance welding, and then we are going to cover or we are going to compare resistance welding with other types of welding. So it is important that you know why resistance welding is different from other welding techniques. In your exam also, it is important for you guys to select the correct process, right? So to know the selection of the correct process of welding, what is important is that you should know why this type of welding is better or superior to other types of welding. So that is what we need to learn in the comparison. So this is our brief content and overview of today's lecture and the lecture on Thursday. So let's start with the process of resistance welding. And what is resistance welding? So resistance welding basically is a process. Resistance welding is a process in which the workpiece is welded by a combination of heat and pressure sufficient enough for localized melting or joining. Sometimes melting will occur, sometimes only joining will occur metallurgically. At the contact. So resistance welding is a welding process in which the workpiece are welded due to combination of pressure applied to them and the heat which is generated by an electric resistance or a high electric current which is flowing through the contact area of the weld. So this is resistance welding definition, basic definition. So what is the mechanism and how electric resistance welding works? So what it is saying, I've got two pieces, piece of metals, okay? It could be any piece, it could be aluminium, magnesium, titanium, or steel, okay? So I've got two pieces of material, okay? When we are joining pieces in this fashion, okay, this is called a butt joint, B-U-T-T, butt joint, because you know this line or this circle looks like a butt, because you've got a line here, this is a butt line, so that is why it is called a butt joint. And when I'm going to put this piece on top of this piece, then it is called overlap, and this is called lap joint, okay? Lap overlapping, so it comes from the word overlap. So lap joint is when my piece is on top of this piece. It can be partial lap overlap, or it can be full overlap as well. Full overlap or partial overlap as well, okay? So as you can see in the figure as well, if you can see here in the figure, okay, this figure, you've got two piece, okay? This piece can be called work piece as well. So it can be work piece as well, okay? So these two can be work piece or the parts that are to be welded together. This key piece can be steel and this piece can be aluminium, and I can join them together. So when my two materials are different, they are called dissimilar materials welding. Okay, if both of them are aluminium, as you can see in our case, both of them are aluminium, so they are similar welding, similar materials welding. Okay, similar materials welding is easy to weld because the material are similar. However, if my material is dissimilar, then it is very difficult to weld, because this material and these two materials cannot mix or cannot match so easily, and the metallurgical bonding is going to be very difficult. So that is why it is easy to break them when tensile force is applied. Okay, however, for similar materials welding, it is quite easy. So the challenge is nowadays that for automotive car applications or for aircraft applications, what we need is, we don't need a single material, we need dissimilar materials. Such as I want to weld magnesium with aluminium, okay? Then what happens is that I can have the strength of aluminium and the ductility of magnesium. So I can have both combination together. But to have both combination together, we need to weld them together as well. Now for fusion welding or the welding in which melting occurs, it is not possible to join dissimilar materials so easily. However, if you have seen the videos in my previous slides, then you must have understood that dissimilar materials can be welded together very easily by solid state welding processes, because usually the melting is not very, there is no melting, or even if there is melting, it is not very sufficiently high. So resistance welding, the one which we are going to learn today, is also depending on dissimilar material as well. We can weld similar material as well as we can weld dissimilar material. And usually what happens is that lab welding is carried out, okay? Lab welding, one on top of other, not the butt welding. So as you can see in the figure, we have got two plates, plate number one and plate number two. or one on the top of the other. Okay. Now what is happening is that in resistance welding, if I'm going to increase this diagram size, okay, I've got an electrode. Okay, you have seen electrode for gas tungsten arc welding and MIG welding as well. So I have got an electrical electrode, and that electrical electrode is touching the workpiece. In the arc welding, basically, it was not touching. Basically, there was a small gap, and that's within that small gap, an arc was produced, right? However, in electrical resistance welding, it is important to touch the workpiece. Without touching, the current will not flow. So once the current flow, when you touch the material, only then the current will flow. So resistance welding is based on the fact that you are going to flow current through electrodes. Okay, so it means that there are going to be two electrodes, and you've got two workpiece material, workpiece material number one and workpiece material number two, and these overall are going to give a combined resistance effect. So force, so we have got two materials. First I clamp them together. Now they are clamped. Okay, now I'm going to put my electrode number one and electrode number two below. Okay, electrode can be same material, so I can have same type of electrode, or I can have different electrode also. So if my material is different, I've got steel here, then I can have a different electrode here, and I've got aluminium here, so I can put a different electrode here. So we can have different electrode and same electrode as well, depending on the material that we're going to weld. So once both my electrodes are touching, okay, then I apply force first. First thing is to apply force to clamp them together. Once the force is applied, then I'm going to start the current. So the current is going to flow from my electrode through workpiece number one, then through workpiece number two, and then through the electrode number two. Okay. Then what happens is that when the current is passed, then the heat is produced. Once the heat is produced, there is some joining or plasticizing of material or melting of material, either plasticizing or melting of material. And then after that, what happens? I remove the current, but keep the force, and then I release the force. So the current is left, and then the force is left, and then what I get is I have got a jointed material. So this is electrical resistance welding. In the previous arc welding techniques, there was a gap between electrode, but here we are basically touching the material. So I've got some example. So this is an example of butt joint, okay, where my material is going to be joined in this fashion. Okay, so I'm going to join them in this fashion. So this is a butt joint, okay, and this is an example of gas metal arc welding. Okay, so here you can see you've got a filler material which has been added. So since the filler material has been added, you can see that it is basically coming outside the, there is excess material. Okay, so it is coming outside from the top, while from the bottom also, some in some portions it is coming outside, and in some portion it is not coming outside. Okay, so these portion are full penetration, and these portion are partial penetration. It means that my current or voltage was not sufficient enough for going full penetration like this. So this is a butt joint, and usually arc welding processes are good for butt joint and lap joint both. However, resistance welding is specifically good for butt joint, but not as good for, is specifically good for lap joint, which I showed you earlier on, but not as good for the butt joint. However, butt jointing can be done also in resistance welding. So now that you have gone through the basics, okay, what happens is that the current is going to flow through electrode number one, okay. Now There is one more thing. Now I have got this material and I have got this material. When I am going to put one material on top of the other material, there is still some air gap between them. Okay. As I am putting this material on top, okay, if you see this area, the contact area microscopically, then this is my workpiece number one, and this is my workpiece number two. So what I am saying is that because of the surface roughness, the surface of the material is not flat, okay. The surface of material is always, it has got some peaks and valleys, okay. So due to the surface roughness between them, there is some gap. So in between there we have got air gap. Okay. So when I'm going to put this material on this material, there is going to be an air gap present. Okay. Then when I'm going to put my electrode on workpiece number one, there is going to be another air gap. And then when I'm going to put another workpiece, electrode below workpiece number two, then there will be a third air gap due to surface roughness. So there are going to be three air gaps, remember, between electrode and workpiece, between two workpiece, and between the workpiece and the electrode. And these three air gaps give rise to contact resistance. Okay. So because of this air gap, what we get is contact resistance. Okay. Means that I am contacting, and due to the contact resistance due to the air present in between the surface roughness. So as you know that in resistance welding, the resistance is very important. So one is the contact resistance. What is the other one? One we use contact resistance, the other is bulk resistance. What is bulk resistance? Basically, when a current is applied between two ends, okay, then the material through which the current flows, that material has its own resistivity, okay, and that own resistivity gives rise to bulk resistance. Bulk resistance depends on how large is the area, okay. So this is the cross sectional area. This is the cross sectional area, okay. So how large is the cross-sectional area and what is the length of the conductor? So I think resistivity is proportional to the length, I think. So the higher the length, the higher would be the resistance. So if you can see here, when my electrode is touching, so this is bulk resistance, okay. This bulk resistance, when it touches, then it goes to contact resistance. Then I have the bulk resistance for my material as well, which I am going to join. So aluminium has different bulk resistance, okay. Then when I'm going to join aluminium to this aluminium, then there is contact resistance. Then the current flows to the workpiece part two, which has its own bulk resistance. And then my electrode is touching here, so it has got contact resistance. And then the electrode, which is at the below of workpiece 2, has its own bulk resistance. So bulk resistance, then contact resistance, then bulk resistance, then contact resistance, then bulk resistance, then contact resistance, and then bulk resistance. So we have got bulk, contact, bulk. We've got seven resistance, okay? So it is a combination of all of these resistance that is going to produce heat, and that heat is going to result in joining of material once the pressure is also applied. Remember, pressure should be applied. Now you know the resistance of a material is a material's property. Okay, resistance are basically resistance of a conductor is its material's resistivity, or it is a material's property. Okay, it is a physical property, and resistance of conductor is equals to material's resistivity multiplied by its length and divided by area. So resistance resistance is directly proportional to length and inversely proportional to cross-sectional area. So here, if you have in general seen, a piece of wire will heat up when the current is passed through it. The actual temperature rise at a joint depends on the specific heat and thermal conductivity of the metals to be joined. This is very, very important as well. So the temperature rise means delta T is dependent on specific heat capacity of a material, Cp, and thermal conductivity of material, K. K is in heat transfer, you must have learned thermal conductivity and thermal conductivity in specific heat capacity. So this was the fundamental of resistance welding, introduction to the resistance welding process, and we have covered the fundamentals, what are the basic principles and fundamentals by which the resistance welding works. Let's move to quality control. Okay, that is very, very important. How do we maintain the quality, good strength, good characteristics of our resistance weld? So when we look at this welding quality control for resistance welding, okay, we have got weld quality curves, okay, or weld quality graphs, which we have got two types. Okay, number one is resistance welding current range curve. Okay, number one is called resistance welding current range curve, and number two is resistance welding lobe curve. Sorry, weld quality basically with the process such as resistance spot welding are highly dependent on these curves. So it is very important for me to know that in which range of current I am operating. Okay, so this is my range, acceptable range, this one. I should be operating under this range only. So if I go beyond this range, then what happens is that the nugget formed is undersized. Okay, so it's very small. Okay, if the nugget size is very small, and when I'm going to apply tensile strength, shear strength, then what happens is the material is going to break away. So I don't want a smaller undersized nugget. An undersized nugget happens when the current is low. What happens is my current is very high. If my current is very high, then what happens is the material is ejected from the welding process. So what happens is that a very large bead is formed. Then further melting, what happens? The material is ejected in the form of through pressure and through what you call ejection phenomena. The material is ejected from the material. So in welding, if you have seen a lot of material, sometimes ejected and comes out while you're doing the welding process. So the same thing happens to resistance welding as well. Now both of these basically curves are developed by doing research and by doing a lot of experiments. So if you guys go to Science Direct, then you might guys see some of the curves for different materials. So different materials are going to have different curves, and then these different curves are basically developed by using a lot of experiments. If you look at curve number two, here you've got a relation of welding time and welding current. So if the current is too high and the welding time is also between medium and high, then expulsion happens, okay? And there is only a small range, this is the range, in which we can produce acceptable nugget size, okay? That is very, very important. To verify the quality that my quality is good, okay, I need to do visible examination. Sorry, visible examination cannot be done because the weld nugget is hidden. Okay, so maybe I need to do radiographic testing, okay, or I need to do magnetic particle testing, MPT, to look inside whether the weld is okay or not. Why we cannot see the weld? Because if I look at the top portion of the weld, okay, it is hidden. The top portion is on the top, but the inside portion is, if I look at the cross section, then this portion is hidden actually. I cannot see that. When I cannot see the weld, let's say in this example also, I can see the top portion of the weld, I can see the bottom portion of the weld. I can see, cannot see what is in the middle throughout the length, okay? So that is why, since the inner portion is hidden, so what I need to do is, I need to do some inspection techniques from which I can get confirmation of what is inside. So for resistance welding, visible examination is not possible. That is important to remember. It's a good question. Which welding technique visible inspection is not possible? Okay. So we have covered quality control as well now. Remember, there are two very important graphs. One is current range graph, and the other two is welding lobe curve, okay? And you should know that under which condition the expulsion occurs. Expulsion occurs at very high current and medium to high welding, usually at higher welding time. So now we are going to move to different types of welding, okay, and different types of resistance welding. Resistance spot welding, okay, as the name suggests, this is all about creating a spot only between two materials. So in resistance spot welding, what happens is we have got a circular electrode, okay, this is a circular electrode having a circular cross section, okay. And that circular electrode is basically pressing these two plates, plate one and plate two, to be joined, okay? So the lab joint is pressed by two electrodes. These two electrodes supply very high current for a very short amount of time. And the heat is basically directly proportional to the current and resistivity. So first we apply the force, then we apply the current, then we stop the current and squeeze the joint. Spot weld has a tapered electrode, so that is important to learn. Then we've got another type of weld called projection weld and seam weld also. Seam weld, for projection weld, the workpiece has projection, and for seam weld, it has a roller electrodes. Okay, so this is something we will see in the next slides. So these are basically the types of, this is general resistance welding. Okay, this slide is general resistance welding. And this is type number one, spot, projection, and seam. This is seam. So these are three different types. Each type has a different types of electrode. So for spot welding, we've got a tapered electrode. This is tapered. For projection, we've got a straight electrode. And for seam, we've got a roller as an electrode. So spot welding sequence is that first pressure is applied, as we saw previously, then current is on, then current is off, but pressure is on, and then the pressure is released. And then in the middle, what happens? A weld nugget is formed, and then a heat affected zone is also formed. Okay. What is heat affected zone? So let's assume a case of resistance welding where melting is also occurring. Okay. So these are my two plates. This is the portion where melting occurred. Let's say this is called weld zone or melt zone. Weld nugget. Weld zone. Fusion zone. So you could call this area these three zones. But because of melting, heat is transferred radially also. Okay. Because the cross section is circular, so the heat is transferred through conduction radially into the workpiece. Okay. So the heat transfer causes heat treatment. Okay. Which is called heat affected zone. This is called heat affected zone. So if my base, this is my base material, okay, or workpiece or base material, okay. So if I use a microscope, okay, I am going to analyze all of them in microscope, scanning electron microscope, okay. So let's take a look at base material, okay. So in the microscope, if I see the base material, the grain size looks like this. Okay, coarse grains, the wrought material. Okay, coarse equiaxed grains. Just a second. Okay. So if you look at a workpiece, this is how the grains look like. Okay. Yeah, I was just having a little bit flu. So this is how the base material looks like. Okay. Now, if we see the weld zone where melting has occurred, okay, when melting occurs, the material is liquid. But when the material wants to solidify, small nucleation happens. Okay, small dot dot dots happens. During resolidification, small dot dot dots happen, and these dot dots grow to form small grains. Okay. So smaller grains are produced. Okay. Okay, so this is how the microstructure of a melt or weld zone looks like. But what happens in the heat affected zone? in the heat affected zone, okay, HAZ, because the material has not melted, but the this is where there is no heat for base material, there is no heat, no melting. Okay, for melt zone we have got melting, and because of heat, so heat is very high and melting is also very high. But for a heat affected zone there is no melting, okay, because the material is cooling, but there is heat which is transferred from the weld nugget into the heat affected zone. Okay, so what happens, the grains when they get the heat they grow more, so they even grow more higher sometimes than the base material. So when the base material grains grow very high, the strength, mechanical strength, decreases. Okay, so for base material, let's say the strength is 500 megapascal. Okay, for the melt zone, the grains are very small. So when the grain size reduce, strength increase. So let's say in the weld zone, the strength is 700 megapascal. Okay, but what happens in the heat affected zone? In the heat affected zone, the grains are very large, so the strength has reduced. So the strength has reduced further than the base material, because the grain size is now more higher, or the size of the grains is higher than the base material. So the strength should be lower than the base material. The strength reduces to 400 megapascal. Okay. So what happens is, when I apply tensile load or tensile shear load, okay, when I apply tensile shear load, this is my melt zone, this is my heat affected zone, okay, and this is my base material. So base material, melt zone, heat affected zone. Okay, this is the weld nugget which I form. Let's do some testing, let's do some quality control. Okay, so to do quality control QC, what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply tensile load. Okay, so I'm going to put it under tensile testing machine. Okay, so for doing tensile testing machine, I'm going to apply load on one end and other load on the other end. So what is going to happen is, because the material is weak in the heat affected zone, so let's say the strength of base material was 500, weld zone is 700, and the heat affected zone is 400. So during the tensile test, the material is going to fail in the weakest zone, and the weakest zone is heat affected zone. So the material is going to break from here. So what I've learned is that heat affected zone, HAZ, is sometimes the weakest zone portion of welded or welded material. So that is very important for you guys to understand. Heat affected zone is because of the rapid cooling of the melted zone, the heat is transferred away towards the cooler region. Base material is cooler and melt region is hotter. So the heat transfer from hotter region to cooler region. Okay. So while the heat is passing from hotter region to cooler region, some of the grains are further grown in the heat affected zone. So this is the story in the slide about this heat affected zone that they have written. This is the story behind it. Okay. So you guys now understand the sequence of welding and sequence of spot welding operation. And let's take a look at a video of how the spot welding operates. Okay. Okay. So this film, this video has been captured at 220,000 frames per second. So you will see the welding in a very slow motion. Okay. 9,000 amperes have been given the current and 10 cycles of welding time is given. Okay. The welding force applied is 400 pounds and my material is 0.040 inch thick. So these are electrode number one, electrode number two. Okay. Electrode is tapered. So it means this is an example of spot welding, tapered electrode. This is material number one, and if you can see, there is a small gap, and there is material number two as well. Now, once the first pressure is applied, then current is applied. So once my pressure is applied, and now I'm heating. So once I'm heating, you can see fumes coming out. These are fumes coming out, and usually the fumes are starting more at the contact area. Okay. Contact resistance is high, so contact area fumes are increasing. Anyway, now you can see the this black portion. This black portion is now going to become with a weld nugget. Now melting occurs starting from this area. So here, if you can see, there is a very small spot created. This is due to contact resistance, the small melt portion is created, and then due to the bulk resistance, the melting will occur and it will spread from the contact resistance. So you can see the melting occurring, and after melting, now it is solidifying and cooling. So the cooling starts at the boundary, and then slowly at the center it cools down. Okay, so once again you can observe this phenomena. So this portion is the weld nugget, where these are the plates at the corner. You can see the plates, and looks like this is the heat affected zone, the blackish part. So this was some inside video on the fundamental of spot welding. There is another spot welding video for you guys. So this is basically highly used in automotive sheet metal manufacturing. So if you can see, you can do it manually also. He is doing spot welding at some location. Electrode is put there, and then a weld is created. As I said earlier, the two materials facing each other is the fading surface. So this is on mechanism that you guys can see later on in your class. But in general, basically spot welding is you clamp the material first at certain force, You can see how fast it is and how mobile it is. People are wearing some gloves as well, electrically resistant gloves, or gloves, and they are doing spot welding. So it is robust, it is flexible, and quite easy to perform. And it is very, very famous for car automotive joints. I told you guys about expulsion, right? In the weld quality curves and in the load, in the current lobe curves, you could see that if the current is very high and then the time duration is very high, then expulsion happens. Okay, how expulsion happens, how the material is ejected, you can see this in this video. Okay, so as the temperature increases, first fumes occur, and this is now expulsion which is happening. Material ejection. Okay, so you don't want this. Okay, you don't want this expulsion to occur. It is a quality control issue. The weld strength will be very low. So this is the disadvantage of expulsion. So spot welding, as I said, are used in many automobile companies. Some of the examples of spot welding are like in cutlery as well. Spot welding cookware. The muffler of your car is made from spot welds. There are many small spot welds as well. Now, what is resistance stud welding? Okay, we have gone through resistance spot welding. Let's move on to resistance stud welding. Basically, in resistance stud welding, we have a fastener. Basically, we want screws and bolt, and we want to join screws and bolt to our plate. Okay, so the screw and or nut is basically jointed to a plate. So the screw is also sometimes interchangeably used as a stud. Okay, so basically we join screw or stud through the plate. Okay, so when the welding gun is activated, electrical energy is discharged, melting the base and parent material. Spring load forges the fastener into the molten material. So if we take a look at a video, then only you can understand this process very well. Okay, so if you look here, this is the electrical transformer. Okay, we have got a welding gun. Okay, stud gun. We are going to place our screw in the gun. Okay, okay, and then we are going to start this. So we apply some pressure and we apply electrical resistance, and then the stud is basically jointed to the base plate. That's it. So apply pressure on the stud, the electrical resistance is created between the plate and the stud, and due to resistance welding phenomena, we can have studs being created for our joint. This is how the studs look like, and they have a very good strength as well. So this was electric resistance stud welding. So basically, stud welding is simply used for putting screws and studs onto sheets. Let's move to resistance seam welding. As I said earlier, for resistance spot welding, the electrode is tapered. Okay, for stud welding, the electrode is basically the stud itself. The electrode is basically within the gun. Okay, for seam welding, we've got rollers. Okay, so what we are doing is basically we've got rollers, and those rollers are electrodes. They are basically conducting electricity as they are moving also. Okay, so with this, basically what we can do is we can create a full weld rather than spots. We can create a full weld also. Okay, so this full welding basically, or full weld nugget, is sealable. Okay, so basically we can seal material. we can create sealable material, we can create basically pipes, okay, we can create fuel tanks, okay, we can do different things. If my current is different, or if my current is non-continuous, then I can create weld nuggets at a certain interval, okay. Like in the case of muffler, okay, I can create a muffler also using resistance seam welding, where the roller is the electrode, it moves in certain direction, okay, and it is going to create a weld seam throughout, okay. But the phenomena is same, the current is passing through, okay. So let's take a look at an example of a resistance seam welding. So here we've got two materials, okay. I'm going to put a roller. I will share the videos with you guys as well. The roller is the electrode. A water tube is there for cooling. Continuous joint is created by the help of seam welding. And this is how the roller moves on. So seam welding is used to create pressure vessels, tanks, fuel tanks, okay, containers, heat exchangers, motor casing, nuclear components, pressure vessels, etc. I will show you a live demonstration also for seam welding. I think it's not here, okay. Then we take a look at resistance projection welding. In resistance projection welding, basically, what happens is that we have got basically in resistance projection welding, RPW, high electrical resistance is created at the point, at the joint, by embossing. So basically what we do is we emboss first material onto other and we forge them. Basically it is like applying extremely high pressure and force to, it is quite similar to stud welding, but its application is very different. If you see the example only, then you will understand what is going on. Basically we are forcing the material under high pressure die, okay. So we've got a forging machine or a hydraulic press, and I'm going to press the machine, okay, and create this tool, okay. So basically what is happening is I have got two parts, I press them under hydraulic pressure, there is still some distance, and then now I am going to pressurize them and create a weld by putting electrical energy. So this is how it looks in slow motion. So projection welding is used for creating tools for opening car wheels and stuff. I don't know what it's called, spanner or something. So projection welding is kind of an electrical resistance welding in which we've got some projection, okay. So we have got this part is called projection part, or projection area, and the projection area is the one in which high pressure and resistance is created to create a joint. So the projection can be round, it can be oval shape, or for, it depends on what kind of tool that we are going to make. So it's quite similar to spot welding. And then we have the last part type of weld, which is flash butt welding, okay. Flash butt welding is primarily used in railway tracks welding, okay. Because the primary welding action is caused by forging of the plasticized material, flash butt welding is often considered a solid state welding process, even though the molting material is generated during the flashing process. So once again, melting is occurring, but still we call it solid state welding process because we are forging materials. Forging means that we use extremely high pressure and actually high amount of force to join materials. Basically, forging is a manufacturing process to shape a material, but forging process is used sometimes for welding as well. So flash welding is considered a resistance welding process, but the mechanism of heat generation is very different from other resistance welding process. Okay. So what is flash bed welding? First, we have got two railway tracks, okay? And these two railway tracks I want to join, okay? So first is, we assemble the workpiece in butt joint configuration, okay? So that is very, very important. So as I said you guys earlier, usually in the projection weld also, it was lap joint. In spot weld also, it was lap joint. In stud welding also, it was lap joint. But this is one example where we have got flash butt, means we are doing this butt welding, okay? So resistance welding example for butt joint is flash butt welding, okay? So the railway tracks are to be joined. So first, what they're going to do is assemble the workpiece in butt joint configuration, okay? Then apply low voltage, high current to cause repeated flash sparking. So in arc welding also, what happens is that if the electrode is very near, then sparking happens. So apply low voltage, high current to cause repeated flash sparking in the butt. This will generate heat of the entire butt surface of the current. So once sparking happens, then material becomes melt or plasticized or red hot. Once the material is red hot, then only I put pressure and join them. So in projection welding, I am doing the resistance. I'm putting the electric current and pressure together at the same time. But in flash butt joint welding, I'm first putting electric current first. After putting the electric current first, I heat the material. After heating the material and making it plastic, then only I put forging force, okay? So once I put the forging force only, then my material is jointed. So there is some process difference between flash butt welding and resistance butt welding. The limitation of this process is that we require very high current and very high amount of force. Its application, very good application, is welding of railway tracks. So let's take an example. So this is a video I've shared with you guys. You guys maybe can see it later on. So first of all, what they're doing is, I think this is another type of welding, if I'm not mistaken. But let's take a look that if they are doing the flash butt welding operation, then they are putting, yeah, so they are basically grappling the pipes. The railway tracks are, you've got two railway tracks. Now they are going to create a flash. Now the flash is produced. After the flash is produced, then they are going to put forging force. So now you can see it is going moving in the downward direction to create a forging force. After the forging force is done, we can see the material is still red hot, and the flash or the excess material is removed. This is called flash. What is flash? Anything which is excess in material. Actually, if let's say I am welding a tube, okay. Okay, and then the excess material is created. Okay, so this is flash and it can be removed later on. So you can see they are removing the excess flash later on. And we have got a railway track. You put a railway track which is ready for, which has been jointed. So later on, you guys can go through this flash butt welding process. So